town of Moore. We are so happy to see all these people here. It's great. We worked so hard on this play. There's absolutely nothing better on campus to do right now. There's nothing else you could be doing than being here. So we're so happy. So this is a comedy, so seeing all these people, we want all of y'all to laugh as hard as you can at the worst moments, at the best moments. So just, we'll try to have fun as actors, and you guys also try to have fun as the audience. So we're so happy to see you guys. General rules of note, actors will be running up and down the aisles throughout the show. So just be aware when you get up to go use the restroom or anything like that. This is Shakespeare. It's gonna be quite confusing at first once you start listening to the language. So let me tell you a bit about the play first. This play is all about mistaken identity. It's really kind of all about that. It's about two pairs of twins who in 1 second.
Merchants, our elderly countrymen, but wanting guildless to redeem their lives, spilt their vigorous statues with their blood. For since the daily internal wars, twixt that seditious countrymen and us, it hath in solemn synods been decreed by adverse towns to admit no traffic. Now, if any born in the Bay of Ephesus,
if any
born in the Bay of Ephesus be seen in any Syracusan marts and fairs, he dies.
Wait, what?
His goods confiscate to the Duke dispose, to me. Unless 1,000 marks be levied to acquit the penalty and to ransom him, thy substance valued at the highest rate cannot amount to 100 marks, then by law thou art condemned to die.
Yet this is my comfort. When your words are done, my woes in likewise with the evening sun.
Well, merchant of Syracuse, say in brief the cause of my last departure from the home and came to the Bay of Ephesus.
Ephesus!
A heavier task could not have been imposed than I to speak my griefs unspeakable. In Syracuse I was born and wed unto a woman happy, but for me, and by me and none other than that, our wealth increased by prosperous voyages I often made to Epidamium, until my business partner's death.
Oh.
And the great care of goods at random left drew me from loving embracements of my spouse, from whom my absence was not but 6 months old before she herself almost fainted under the pleasing punishment that women bear, and made permission to follow and sit in safe arrive where I was. There she had not been long, but she became the of two goodly sons, which was strange, one so like the other as could not be distinguished. That very hour, in the self same inn, a poor woman was delivered of such a burden.
We're twins!
Male twins, both alike. These, for their parents were exceedingly poor, and lost, and brought up to attend my sons. My wife, extremely proud of two such boys, made daily requests for our home return. Alas, I agreed. Too soon we came aboard. A league from Epidamium had we sailed. Before the always window-bearing deep gave an ominous sign of our harm. But longer did we not retain much hope, would obscure light the heavens did grant, if I convey unto our feeble minds a doubtful warrant of immediate death. The sailors sought forsaking lifeboats and left the ship, then sinking right to us. My wife, more careful for the ladder board, cast him under a small, spare mast.
Small?
Such as seafaring men provide for storms. And to him, one of the other twins was bound. Whilst I have been like heedful of the others. The children thus disposed, my wife and I, fixing our eyes on whom our care was fixed. Now to ourselves, neither of the mast, and floating straight, obedient to the stream, were carried towards Corinth, so we thought. At length, the sun, gazing upon the earth, dispersed those clouds that defended us, and by his wishing light, the seas waxed calm. And we discovered two ships, making a main to us, of Corinth that.
Corinth!
Of Epidaurus this.
Epidaurus!
But there they came, oh, let me say no more. Gather the sequel by what went before.
What?
Do not break up so. Because I will not pity, though. I will pardon.
Yeah. Oh, had the gods done so? For I not now worthily term them merciless to us. For ere the ships can meet, but twice 5 leagues, we encountered a mighty rock.
Oh, God! Oh, God!
Seeing his burden with lesser weight, but not with lesser woe, was carried with greater speed before the wind. And in our sight, they three were taken up by fishermen of Corinth. At length, another ship had seized on us, and knowing whom it was in their hat to save, gave healthful welcome to their shipwrecked guests, and would have wrecked the fishers of their prey, had not their bark been very slow and set. And thus, homeward did they bend their course. So have you heard me, severed from my bliss, and thus was my life prolonged to tell sad stories of my own mishaps.
And for the sake of them thou sorrowest for, do continue to tell me what hath befallen of them and they till now.
At 18 years, my youngest son, and yet my eldest care, became inquisitive after his brother, and it importuned me that his attendant, so his case was like, reft of his brother, but retained his name, might accompany him in the quest of him whom, whilst I labored of a love to see, I hazarded the loss of whom I loved. 5 summers have I spent in furthest Greece, coming clean from the bounds of Asia, and sailing homeward, came to Ephesus, hopeless to find them, and yet loath to leave unsought this or any other place that harbors men. Yet it must end the story of my life. But happy were I in my timely death, could all my travels warrant me, they live.
Oh, poor Aegeon, who the fates embarked to bear the extremity of thy mishap. Now trust me, if it was against my laws, my oath, and my dignity, I would sue advocacy. But now to judge the death, and I mean, I can't personally do anything about it. But I will favor thee in what I can today. To seek thy help by beneficial help. I mean, try all the friends thou hast with feasting.
Access!
It's not a real place. And listen. If you don't, thou'st condemned to die. Hey, thou'st condemned to die. Okay? Jailer! Dude!
What?
Go get him! It's your job.
I will, my lord.
You got it, tiger.
Hopeless and helpless, thought the Aegean win, but to procrastinate his life within.
Shut up!
Therefore, get out of Epidanium, lest that your goods too soon be confiscated. For this very day, a Syracusan merchant is apprehended for his arrival here, and not being able to buy his own life according to the statutes of the town, dies here, the weary son, sad from the west. On a far brighter note, here is your money that I was given to keep.
Go, bear to the centaur where we host. Stay there, Dromio, till I come to thee. Within the hour shall be dinner time. Till then, I'll peruse the traders and view the manners of the town, and then come to my men and dine. For with long travel, I am stiff and weary. Get thee away.
Many a man would take you at your word, and go indeed having such good a mean.
The trusty villain, sir, that very oft, when I'm dull with care and melancholy, lightens my humor with his merry jest. What, will you walk about the town with me, and then go to my inn and dine with me?
I am inclined, sir, to certain merchants.
Of whom I hope to make much benefit.
I crave your pardon, sir, soon at 5 o'clock, I'll meet with you upon the mart, and consort with you until bedtime. My present business calls me from you now.
Farewell till then. I shall go walk about the town.
Sir, I commend you to your own content.
He that commends me to mine own content, commends me to the thing I cannot get. I to the world am like a drop of water, that falling there to find his fellow forth, unseen, inquisitive, found himself. So I to find a mother and a brother, in quest of them, unhappy, lose myself.
Hey!
Here comes the almanac of my true date. What now? How chance thou it return so soon?
Return so soon? Rather approach too late! The capon burns, the pig falls from the spit, the clock has struck 12 upon the bell! My mistress made a one upon my cheek. She is so mad because the meat is cold. The meat is cold because you come not home. You come not home because you have no stomach. You have no stomach, having broke your fast. But we that know it is to fast and to pray, God bless you, are penitent for your default today.
Stop in your wind, sir. Tell me, where's the gold I gave to you?
Sixpence I had Wednesday last to pay the saddler from Mistress's crupper. The saddler had it, sir. I kept it not.
I'm not in a sportive humor now. Tell me, and tell me not, in what safe place you have bestowed my gold. We being strangers here, how dare thou trust so great a charge from thine own custody?
I pray you jest, sir, as you sit at dinner. I, from my mistress, come to you in post. If I return, I shall be post indeed, for she will score your fault upon my pate. Oh, methinks your tummy, like mine, should be your clock, and strike you home without a messenger.
Come, Dromio, come. These jests are out of season. Save them till a merrier hour than this. Where is the gold I gave to you?
To me? Sir, you gave no gold to me.
Come, sir knave, have done your foolishness. Tell me how thou hast disposed thy charge.
My charge was but to fetch you from the mart, home to your house of the Phoenix, sir, to dinner. My mistress and her sister stays for you.
Now, as I am a Christian, answer me. In what safe place you have bestowed my gold? I shall break that merry sconce of yours that stands on tricks and jests when I am undisposed. Where is the 1,000 marks thou hadst of me?
I have some marks of yours, sir, upon my pate, some of my mistresses upon my shoulders, but not 1,000 marks between you both. Perhaps if I were to pay your worship those again, you would not bear them patiently.
Thy mistress, Marks? What mistress hast thou, knave?
Your worship's wife. My mistress at the Phoenix. She that doth fast till you come home to dinner and pray that you will hie you home to dinner.
What, will you flop me thus into my face there? Take me.
What means you, sir, for God's sake? Hold your hands. Nay, if you will not, I'll take my heels.
By some device or other, the villain is overwrought with all my money. They say this town is full of cousinage, nimble jugglers that deceive the eye, dark-working sorcerers that kill the mind, soul-killing witches that deform the body, disguised cheaters, prating mountebanks, many such like liberties of sin. If it proves so, I'll be gone the sooner. I'll to the centaur to seek this knave. I greatly fear my money is not safe.
Master and his servant have not yet returned. That in such haste I sent to seek his master. Sure, Luciana, it is 2:00.
Well, perhaps some merchant hath invited him. And from the Martins, somewhere gone to dinner. Good sister, let us dine and never fret. Ow! Man is master of his liberty. Time is their master. And when they see time, they'll go. If so, be patient, sister.
Why should their liberty than ours be more?
Because their business still lies at our door.
When I serve him so, he takes it ill.
Oh, no, he is the bridle of your will.
There's none but asses will be bridled so.
Why, headstrong on liberty is lashed with woe. There's nothing situate under heaven's eye but hath his bound in earth, in sea, in sky.
Oh, God.
Man, more divine, the master of all of these, lord of the wide world and wild watery seas, endued with intellectual sense and souls of more preeminence than fish and fowls, our masters to their females and their lords. So, let your will attend on their accords.
Oh my God, it's this servitude that makes you to keep unwed.
Not this, but troubles of the marriage bed.
But were you wedded, you would bear some sway.
Ere I learn love, I'll practice to obey.
How if your husband starts some other where?
Till he come home again, I would forbear.
Patience unmoved! No marvel, though she pause. They could be meek but have no other cause. A wretched soul, bruised with adversity. We may be quiet when we hear it cry. But we were burdened with like weight of pain. And for that we ourselves should complain. Thou hast no unkind maid to grieve thee. With urging helpless patience would relieve me. But if thou live to be like me bereft, this fool begging patience in thee will be left.
Well, I will marry one day, but to try. Oh, look, here comes your man. Now is your husband nigh.
Say now, is your tardy master now at hand? Nay, he's at two hands with me. And that, my two ears can witness. Say, didst thou speak with him? Knows thou his mind?
Aye, he told his mind upon mine ear. For sure with hand, I could scarce understand it.
Spake he so doubtfully thou couldst not feel his meaning?
Nay, he struck so plainly that I could too well feel his blows. And bespoke his hand, I could scarce understand it.
But I say, prithee, is he coming home? Surely he should take greater care to please his wife.
My mistress, surely my master is horn mad.
Horn mad?
Yes.
A horn mad.
That one fell out!
No, what?
No, sorry!
Oh, God! No. Not like cuckold mad, not like that.
But sir, mistress, he is stark mad. When I desired to come home to dinner, he asked me for 1,000 marks in gold. 'Tis dinner time, quoth I. My gold, quoth he. Your meat doth burn, quoth I. My gold, quoth he. Will you come, quoth I. My gold, quoth he. Where's 1,000 marks a half to me? Dinner! I'm sorry. Your meat, quoth I, doth burn. My gold, quoth he. My mistress, sir, quoth I. Hang up thou, mistress! I know not thy mistress! Out of thy mistress!
Quoth who?
Quoth my master. I know, quoth he. No house! No what? No mistress! So that my errand do unto my tongue, I thank him. I bear home on my shoulders. For in conclusion, you didn't beat me there.
Go back again, Dave, and fetch him home.
Go back again and be newly beaten home? For God's sake, church on all the Russian here.
Back, Dave, or I will break thy pate across.
And he will bless that cross with other beating. This is good. Between you, I shall have holy head.
Well, hence. Breaking peasant.
I said fetch the master.
Oh, God.
Okay, look. Am I so round with you as you with me that like a football, you do spurn me thus? You spurn me hence? Oh! You spurn me hither! I should last in this service. You will have to case me in leather.
The door.
Thank you.
Come in peace, love. Fie, beat it hence.
His company must seem to do his minions grace, whilst I starve at home for a merry look. Hath homely age the alluring beauty took from my poor cheek, and he hath wasted it. Are my disclosures stole, bare in my wit? If voluble and sharp discourse be marred, unkindness blunts it more than marble hard. Do their gay vestments his affection's fate? That's not my fault. He's the master of my estate. What ruins are in me that can be found by him not ruined? And he is in the ground of my defeatures, my decayed beauty. A sunny look of his would soon repair.
Out of patience, floweth in your face.
I'm feeling fools can with such wrong suspense. I know his eyes off how much other wear, or else one lets it, but he would be here. Sister, you know he promised me a chain, without alone, oh love, he would detain, so he could keep fair quarter with his bed. Since that my beauty cannot please his eye, I'll weep what's left away, weeping I.
How many fond fools to serve mad jealousy.
The gold I gave to Dromio is buried up safe at the Centaur, and the heedful knave that wandered forth and cared to seek me out. By computation, mine host report, I've not seen him since at last I saw him from the mart. See, here he comes now. How now, sir, is your merry humor altered? As your love stokes, so jest with me again. You know no centaur? You receive no gold? Your mistress sent to have me home to dinner? My house was at the Phoenix? What, wast thou mad that thus so madly didst answer me?
What is he, sir? Whence make I such a word? Even here, even now, not half an hour since. I haven't seen thee since he sent me hence, home to the Centaur with the gold he gave me.
Villain, thou liest! Thou didst deny the gold receipt, told me of a mistress and a dinner, which I hope thou felst I was displeased.
I'm glad it seems very vain, sir. But what means this jest? Tell me.
What? Will you flout me thus unto my teeth? There, take you that.
And that. Good! Stop! Now your jest is earnest, the whole bargain you've given me.
Because that I familiarly do sometimes use you for my fool, and chat and jest with you, your sauciness would jest upon my love, and make it common on my serious hours. When the sun shines, let foolish gnats make sport, but creeping cranny when he hides his beams. If you seek to jest with me, know my aspect, and fashion your looks to my demeanor, or I shall beat this method in your sconce.
Sconce, you call it. You will leave bad ones. I would rather be ahead and use these blows long. I must get a sconce in my head and sconce it too. But tell me, sir, why am I beaten?
Dost thou not know?
No, but I am beaten.
Shall I tell you why?
Aye, sir, wherefore? For to say every why hath a wherefore.
Why, first, for flouting me, and wherefore, the second time urging it.
Was there ever a man beaten out of season, waiting to why and wherefore, say a rhyme nor reason? Well, sir, I thank you.
Thank me, sir, for what?
For giving me something for nothing!
Next, I'll make amends to give you nothing for something. But say, is it dinner time?
Hi, sir. I think you mean last that I have.
In good time, sir. What's that?
Basin.
And twill be dry.
But be it, sir, I hope you eat none of it.
Why's that?
Lest it make you so choleric and personally in our dry basting.
Well, sir, then learn to jest in good time, for they say there's a time for all things.
Lest it make you so choleric, sir.
By what rule?
By a rule as plain as a plain ball pit of fodder time itself.
Let's hear it.
There's no time for a man to recover his hair lost by nature.
May you not do it by fine and recovery?
Yes, to purchase a wig and recover the lost hair of another man.
Why is time such a miser of hair, being such plentiful and excrement as it is?
It is a blessing bestowed upon these, that he has scanted man hair than given them wit.
Why, but there's many a man hath more hair than wit.
Ah, but not a man of those hath the wit to lose his hair.
Why, you just concluded hairy men, plain dealers without wit.
The plainer dealer, the sooner lost, and he loses it in his jollity.
Why, you would have all this time proved there's no time for all things.
Thus I meant it. Time itself is bold. And to the world's end shall I have all followers. I knew it would be a bold conclusion.
Tiphys,
but
something who walks us yonder. Tiphys, it's me.
It's her.
Okay. I see how it is then.
High-eyed Tiphys looks so strange and frowned. Some other mistress hath thy sweet aspects. I'm no longer Adriana. Really, wife? The time was once when thou on urge wouldst vow. That never music pleasing to thine ear, and never object pleasing to thine eye, and never hand soft to thy touch, and never meat sweet savor in thy taste. Unless I looked, or I spake, or I touched, or I craved of thee. How comes it now, my husband? Oh, how comes it that thou art then estranged from thyself? Thyself, I call it, being estranged to me. That undividable, incorporate, and better for thy dear self, better part. Do not tear away thyself from me. For you know, my love, as easy may as well fall, a drop of water in the breaking gulf, it take unmingled thence, and without addition or diminishing, take from me and not me too. How quick when it thee to touch, but here I were licentious, and that this body, consecrated to thee by ruffian lust, should be contaminate? Would thou not spit at me, and spurn at me, and hurl the name of husband in my face, and tear the stained skin from my harlot brow, and with my false hand cut the wedding ring, and bring it with a deep divorcing vow? I know thou canst. So therefore I see thou do it. No, I am possessed with an adulterate blood. My blood is mingled with the crime of lust. For if we two be one, and thou plays false, I do digest the poison of thy flesh, being strumpeted by thy contagion, and keep true league with thy fair bed. I live this day, thou undishonored.
Speak you to me? I know you not. In Ephesus I'm but 2 hours old, a stranger to your town as to your talk, which in all wit being scanned, lacks wit in all one word to understand.
Oh my God.
Fie, brother, how the world has changed with you. When were you wont to use my sister thus? She sent for you by Dromio home to dinner.
By Dromio?
But by me.
Yeah. By thee, yeah. And that he did return thee, and in his buffet he denied my house for his, me for his wife.
Did you converse, sir, with this gentlewoman? What is the course and drift of your compact?
I've never seen her till this time.
How can she call us by our names then? Must it be by inspiration?
How ill agrees it with your gravity to counterfeit thus grossly with your man? Or me in my mood. Come, for I will fasten on this thing with thine. Thou art an elm, my husband, I a vine, whose weakness, married to thy stronger state, gives me greater strength to communicate. If it possess me, it is dross, usurping ivy, briar, or isle moss, who, for all want of pruning with intrusion, infect thy sap, and live on thy confusion.
To me she pleads. She moves me for her theme. What, was I married to her in a dream? Or sleep I now and think I hear all this, but drives our eyes and ears amiss? Until I know the sure uncertainty, I'll entertain the awkward fallacy.
Come, Dromio, go put the servants' spread for dinner.
Oh, for our prayer of bees, they cross before a sinner. This is a fairyland! Oh, spine of spice, we taught with goblins, owls, and sprites. If we obey them not, this will ensue. They'll soak our breath in pitches black and blue.
Why pray'st thou to thyself and answerest not? Dromio, thou Dromio,
thou snail, thou slug, thou sot!
I'm a transformed! Master, am I not?
I think thou art mine, and so am I.
Both in mine and in my shape.
If thou art transformed to aught, 'tis to an ass.
'Tis true she rides me.
What?
Come on, brass. 'Tis so I am an ass. Else it can never be, but I know her as she is.
And that's it. No longer will I be a fool to put the finger in the eye and weep, whilst man and master laughs my woes to scorn.
Come, sir, to dinner. Dromio, keep the gate. Husband, I'll dine above with you today and forgive you of 1,000 idle pranks. Sister, you dine with us. Sira, if any ask for your master, say he dines forth and let no creature enter. Come, husband. Dromio, play the porter well.
My earth and heaven are in hell, waking or sleeping. Matter well advised, known unto myself or to myself disguised. I'll say as they say and sever so, and at all adventures go.
Master, shall I be born at the gate?
Aye, and let none enter, lest they break your pave.
Come, Tiflis, we time too late.
Truage, when I keep not hours. Say that I lingered with you at your shop just in the making of her carcinet, and that tomorrow you'll bring it home. Here's the man that would face me down. He met me on the mart, and then I beat him and charged him with 1,000 marks of gold, and I deny both my life and my house. Thou drunkard thou, what sayest you?
Say what you will, sir, but I know what I know, that you beat me at the mark. I have your hand to show. If skin were parchment and blows you gave were ink, your own handwriting would tell you what I think.
I think thou art an ass.
Mary, so it doth appear by the wrongs I suffer and the blows I bear. I should kick being kicked, and being in that pass, you would flee from my heels. Woo! And beware of an ass.
What's that? See who Balthazar. Pray God Archie may match my goodwill and your good welcome. Here.
Oh, sir, I hold your dainties cheap and your welcome dear.
Oh, Senor Balthazar. Either flesh or fish, a table full of welcome makes scarce one dainty meal.
Good meat, sir, is common. The average rule affords.
And welcome more common, for that's nothing but words.
Small cheer and great welcome makes a merry feast.
Aye, to a more miserly host the more sparing gets. But though my case be mean, take them a good part. Better cheer may you have, but not with better heart.
Yeah, good job, team now, please.
Stop, my door is locked. Go bid them, one second.
Hey, Maud, Marion, Bridget, Cicely, Gillian, Jim?
Low, mold horse, capon, coxcomb, idiot, patch. Either get me from the door or sit down at the hatch. Dost thou conjure for such wenches? Dost thou conjure for such stores? When the one is one too many, go! Get thee from the door!
What fool has made our porter? My master stayed in the street!
Lest he come once he came from, lest he catch cold on his feet.
Who talks within there? Oh, open the door!
Right, and I'll tell you when, and he'll tell me wherefore.
Wherefore? My dinner. I've not yet dined today.
Nor here you must not. Come again when you may.
What art thou that keeps me out from the house I own?
Depart at this time, and come with Dromio.
Oh, villain! Thou hast stolen both mine office and my name!
The one ne'er got me credit,
the other mickle blame! If thou hadst been Dromio today in my place, thou wouldst have changed thy name for a face, or thy face for an ass!
What a coil is that, Dromio? What a
Let my master in now.
Please don't come so late, and so tell your master.
That may be called now, Loha. Is it?
If you hear him, minion, you'll let us in, I hope.
I thought your master here.
He said no.
So come, help!
Well struck, that was blow for blow.
Thou baggage, let us in.
Can you tell for whose sake?
Your master, knock the door
hard.
Let him knock.
Right, let's go, let me door down.
Who needs all that with a pair of stocks in town?
Who is at the door that keeps all of this noise?
Your town is choked with unruly boys.
Is that you within there, wife? You might have come before.
Oh, your wife's your name. Go, get you from the door.
If you went to pain, master, this name would go sore.
Here, sir, be a cheer, nor welcome. We would fain have either.
In debating which was best, we shall part with neither.
No, it's fine.
Hold on! They stand at the door, master. Bid them welcome hither.
The
something in the wind that we cannot get in.
You would say so, master, if your garments were thin. Your cake here is warm within. You stand here in the cold. It would make a man mad as a buck to be so bought and sold.
Fine, go fetch me something. I'll break open the door.
Bring it here, and I'll break open your knave's face.
A man may break word with you, sir, and words are but wind. Aye, and break in your face, so he not break it behind.
It seems thou wast breaking out upon thee high.
Here's too much out upon me. I pray thee, let me in!
How if fowls have no feathers and fish have no fins?
Go fetch me a crowbar! Go, get thee God, and we are at
well. Enough! Oh, good sir, let not be so.
Get out of your ward, get us a reputation.
Come, help and help. Jaws in the cup as a suspect. Now be all well in the honor of your wife. And once this, you long experience of her wisdom, wisdom of virtue, yes, and modesty. I'll bless you apart where I'm not.
You too?
And tell not, sir, but you well to why at this time the doors are locked against you.
Be ruled by me.
Please, depart in patience, and let us the time for dinner. And leaning comes yourself along to know the region of the stranger's strength. If my strong hand tried to break in, now in this certain passage of the day, a vulgar comment will be made of it. And I yet proposed by the common mob, again to a yet ungodly estimation. That man was foreign children, entering a door upon your grave and your dead. So, for slander alerts upon secession, forever house or gets possession.
Good prevail.
Yay.
Yeah. I was a party quiet, and in spite of birth, succeed. Mean to be married. I know a witch of excellent discourse. Pretty, witty, wild, and yet too gentle. There will we die, this woman that I mean. My wife, I protest without desert, hath oftentimes upbraided me withal. To her will we for dinner. Get thee home and fetch the chain. By this time I know 'tis made. Bring it, I pray, to the Porpentine. For there is the house where be it for nothing but despite my wife. I will bestow it upon mine hostess there. Go. Since mine own doors refuse to entertain me, I'll knock elsewhere to see if they'll disdain me.
I'll meet you at that place some hour hence.
Do so. This jest shall cost me some expense.
Sweet mistress. Your name is else I know not. nor by what wonder you do epitomize, less than your knowledge, more than earth's wonder, more than earth divine. Teach me, dear creature, how to think and speak. Lay open to my earthly gross conceit, smothered errors, feeble, shallow, weak, the folded meaning of your words to see. Against my soul's pure truth, why labor you to make it wander an unknown field? Are you a god?
Nope.
Did you create me new? Transform me then, and to your power I'll yield. But if that I am I, then well I know, your weeping sister is no wife of mine. Nor to her bed no homage do I owe. Far more to you do I incline. Sing, sweet mermaid, not to drown me in thy sister's flood of tears. Sing, siren, for thyself, and I will dote. Spread over the silvery waves thy golden hairs. And out of bed, I'll take them in their lie, and in that glorious supposition think he gains by death that has such means to die. Let love, being light, be drowned if she sink.
What? Are you mad that you do reason so?
Not mad, but mated. How? I do not know.
It's a fault that springeth from your eye.
You're gazing on your beams, fair son, being by.
Gaze where you should, and that will clear your sight.
As good to wink, sweet love, as look on night.
Why do you call me love? Call my sister so.
My sister's sister.
That's my sister.
No, it's thyself. Mine own self's better part. My eyes, clear eye. My dear heart's dearer heart. My mood, my fortune, my sweet hope's aim. My solar's heaven, my heaven's claim.
All this my sister is, or else should be.
Call thyself, sister sweet, for I am thee. Thee shall I love, and with thee lead my life. Thou hast no husband, nor I no wife. Give me thy gown.
Stop, sir. Hold me still. I'll fetch my sister to get her goodwill.
How now, Dromio? Where runnest thou so fast?
Do you know me, sir? Am I your man? Am I myself?
Thou art my man? Thou art thyself?
I am an ass. I'm a woman's man beside myself.
What woman's man? And how besides thyself?
Harry, sir, I am dear to a woman. One that claims me, one that haunts me, and one that will have me.
What claim lays she to thee?
Such a claim as you will lay to your horse, she will have me as a beast. I, being a very beastly creature, lays claim to her.
What is she?
A very reverent body. Nay, such as one as you may not speak of. I have the lean luck in imagining that she is a wondrous fat marriage.
How dost thou mean a fat marriage?
Very, sir. She's a kitchen wench in all Greece. I know not what use to purge you, but to make a lamp for her and run her by her own light. I warned her razzing towels in that will burn a pole in winter. If she lives, she'll do things, she'll burn a week longer than the whole world. And she sweats. A man may go over shoes in the ground with it.
What's her name?
No, sir. But her name in three quarters is L in three quarters. Can I measure from hip to hip?
Then she bears some breath.
No longer from head to foot than from hip to hip. She is spherical, like a globe. I can find countries in her. This judge divine really claimed to me. Call me Dromio. Told me my private ones. That's the mark on my shoulder, the wart on my neck, the mole on my great arm. I ran from her as a witch.
Go, hide me. Presently, post to the road. If the wind blow any way from shore, we shall not harbor in this town tonight. If everyone knows our name, we know none. Tis time, I think, to trudge back and be gone.
As a bear, a man will run for his life. I shall fly from her that would be my wife.
There's none but witches do inhabit here. Therefore, tis high time that I repent. She that doth call me husband, even my soul doth her wife abhor. But her fair sister, possessed with such a gentle, sovereign grace, hath almost made me traitor to myself. Lest myself be guilty of self-wrong, I'll stop mine ears against the mermaid's song.
Master Antipolis!
Aye, that's my name.
Oh, I know it well, sir. Lo, here's the chain. I thought to obtain you at the Porpentine. The chain unfinished made me stay thus long.
What is your will that I shall do with this?
What please yourself, sir? I have made it for you.
Made it for me? I bespoke it not.
No, not once. nor twice but 20 times you had. Go home and please your wife withal. Soon, at supper time, I'll receive my money for the chain.
No, I pray you receive the money now, for fear you ne'er see chain nor money more.
Oh, you are a merry man, sir. I fare thee well.
What I should think of this, I cannot tell. But this I think, there's no man is so vain that would refuse so fair an offered chain. I see a man here needs not live by ships, when in the streets he meets such golden gifts. While to the Martin therefore drove me away, then he should put out, then straight away.
Thank you.
Walk me down to his house. I'll discharge my bond and I'll thank you too.
Sure, but not way my man said see when he comes.
Why go to the goldsmith's house, go down by a rope's end. That hole behind the stove hung my wife and her confederates for locking me out of my doors by day. But stop, I see the goldsmith. Go, get thee gone by that rope's end and bring it home to me.
I buy £1,000 a year. I buy a rope.
Master Antipolis.
Hey, a man as well hope up that trust to you. I promised it both your presence and the chain, but neither chain nor goldsmith came to me. Be like you thought our love might last too long, as though it were chained together and therefore came not.
you are very bad. Save me your merry humor. Here's the note. How much your chain weighs to the utmost carat. The finest of gold, in chargeable fashion, which doth amount to 3 odd ducats more than I stand debted to this gentleman. I pray you see him presently discharged, for he is bound to see and he stays but for it.
I'm not furnished with the present money. Besides, I have some business in the town. Go, good senor, take the stranger with you to my house, and take the chain. Bid my wife and disperse the sum on the receipt thereof. Perchance I'll be there as soon as you.
Then you will bring the chain to her yourself.
No, bear with you, lest I come not time enough.
Sir, I will, but have you the chain about you?
And if I have not, I hope you do, sir, else you may return without your money.
Sir, I pray you give me the chain. Both wind and tide stays with this gentleman, and I'd blame have held him here too long.
Good Lord, you use this dalliance to excuse your breach of promise to the Porpentine. I should have chid you for not bringing the chain, but like a shrew, you first began to brawl.
The hour still was on, sir. I pray you dispatch.
You hear how he importunes me? The chain.
What, go take it to my wife and bet your money.
You know I gave it to you even now. Either send me the chain or give me some token.
Now you run this humor out of breath. Where's the chain? I pray you let me see it.
My business cannot brook this dalliance. Good sir, say whether you answer me or no. If not, I will attach him by this officer.
Answer you? What should I answer you?
The chain.
The money that you owe me for the chain.
I owe you none until I receive the chain.
You know I gave it to you half an hour since.
You gave me none. You wrong me, must you say so?
You wrong me more, sir, in denying it. Consider how it stands upon my credit.
Well, officer, arrest him at my suit.
I do arrest you, sir, and charge you in the Duke's name. You obey me.
This touches me in reputation. Either consent to pay this sum for me, or I attach you by this officer.
Consent to pay me that which I never had? Arrest me, foolish fellow, if thou darest.
Okay. Here is the fee, officer. Arrest him. I would not spare my brother in this case if he should scorn me so apparently.
I do arrest you, sir. You would hear the suit.
I will obey thee till I give thee bail.
But sirrah, you shall buy the sport as dear, as all the metal in your shop shall answer.
Sir, I will have law and emphasis to your notorious shame. I doubt it not.
Master, there's a ship of Epidemia that waits till our owner comes aboard, and then she sails away. Our baggage, sir, have been made upon the board. I have bought the oil, the basilum, the aquavita. The ship is in her merry trim, the wind blows fair from land. It went not at all before her master, owner, and yourself.
How now? Madman? Thou peevish sheep, what ship of Epidamium stays for me?
Ship is sent for, tired of hostage!
I sent thou to buy a rope's end, and told you to what purpose?
You sent me to the bay for a ship.
I'll consider this matter at more leisure, and teach your ears to list me with more heed. To Adriana, villain, hide thee straight. Give her this key, and tell her in the death that is covered over with a Turkish tapestry, there's a certain curse of ducats. Let her send it. Tell her I must arrest in the street of Ephesus, and that she'll bail me out. Go on, get thee gone. Onwards, officer, to prison till it come.
Adrian. That's where he died! Where Nell did claim it for her husband. She's too fat for me to compass. Thither I must, although against my will. But for their master it must, their master mine will fulfill.
Did he tempt thee so? My soul perceive austerely in his eye. He did plead in earnest, yea or no. Look he, or red, or sad, or pale, or merely? What observation mad'st thou in this case, of his heart's meteors tilting in his face?
Well, first he denied you had in him no right.
He meant he did mean none, the more my spite.
Then swore he that he was a stranger here.
Hey, true he swore, though forsworn he were.
Then pleaded I for you.
What said he?
That love I begged for you, he begged of me.
With what persuasion did he tempt thy love?
With words that in an honest suit might move. First he did praise my beauty. In my speech.
Did speak him fair?
Have patience, I beseech.
Oh, patience. I cannot, nor I will not. Hold me still. My tongue, though not my heart, shall have his will. He is deformed, crooked, old and sere, ill-faced, worse-bodied, shapeless everywhere, vicious, ungentle, foolish, blunt, unkind, stigmatical, making worse than mine!
Who would be jealous then of such a one? No evil lost is wailed when it is gone.
But I think him better than I say. And herein others' eyes were worse. Far from her nest, the lapwing cries away. My heart prays for him, though my tongue do curse.
Oh. Here, the desk, the purse! Mistress, sleep, my case!
How hast thou lost thy breath?
By running fast.
Where is thy master, Jovian? Is he well?
He's in tartar limbo, worse than hell. A devil in everlasting garment had him. A shoulder climber, a fiend, a fetty, pitiless and rough, a bashing, nay worse, a fellow all above. A shoulder climber, who howled on his countenance, and at the end, drags poor souls to hell.
Why, ma'am, what is the matter?
I know not the matter, but he's arrested on the case.
What, is he arrested? Tell me whose suit.
I know not at whose suit, but he is arrested. Mistress, the money, the desk, please.
No mention, sister. This I wonder at, that he should meet him dead. Tell me, was he arrested on a bond?
Not on a bond, but on a stronger thing. A chain, chain, you hear me?
With the chain?
No, the bell. Tis time now we're gone, and there were two were left and now the clock. Now the clock strikes one!
As if time were dead, how baldly dost thou reason?
Ah, yes. If any hour meets the sergeant, he turns back for very fear.
As if time were dead, how fondly dost thou reason?
Time is a very bankrupt thing. It was more than he's worth to see. Nay, he's a thief too. Have you not heard men say that time goes on by night and day? And have no reason to turn back an hour in the day?
What are you doing? Here's the money, Dromio. Bear it hence and bring thy master home immediately. Come, sister, for I promise thou wilt not do it. No. That is my comfort and my injury.
I meet but doth salute me, as if I were their well-acquainted friend. And everyone doth call me by my name. Some tender money to me, some invite me. Others give me thanks for kindnesses. Even now, a tailor called me in his shop, and showing fine silks that he had bought for me, therewithal took measure of my body. Sure, these are but imaginary wiles and Lapland sorcerers do inhabit here.
Master, here's the gold he sent me for. Have you got a picture of old Adam, new apparel?
What gold is this? What Adam dost thou mean?
Not the Adam kept the paradise, but the Adam that kept the prison. He that goes in a calf's skin? He that came behind you, sir, like an evil angel, and bid you forsake your liberty.
I understand thee not.
No? God. He, sir, that does more exploits with his nice stick than a Moor's pike.
What? Thou meanst an officer.
Yes! He got it! He got it! Sir, he got it! Yes! The sergeant of the band! He that brings any man that breaks his bond!
Stop in your wind, sir. Tell me, are there any ships put forth?
Why, sir, I say an hour since that the ship expedition put forth tonight. But then were you hindered by the sergeants? Here are the angels that you sent me for.
The fellow's distract, and so am I. And here we wander in illusions. Some blessed power deliver us from hence.
Well met, Master Antipolis. I see you found the goldsmith now. Is that the chain you promised me today?
Satan, avoid! I charge thee, tip me not!
Master, is this Mistress Satan?
It is the devil.
Nay, she is worse. She is the devil's mother! Wench, is ready to appear to man like an angel of light. Light is an effect of fire, and fire will burn! Ergo, my electric will burn. Come down here!
You and your men are marvelous merry, sir. Will you go with me? We'll mend our dinner here.
Master, if you do, expect spoon meat, or be speak a long spoon.
Why, Dromio?
She must have a long spoon, and must eat with the devil!
Avoid this, fiend! What tellst thou me of supping? Thou art, as you are all, a sorceress. I conjure thee, be gone!
Give me the ring of mine you had at dinner, or for my ring, the chain, and I will be gone, sir, and not bother you.
Oh, sound double back for carrying one's nail, a brush, a hair, a drop of blood, a pig, a nut, a cherry stone, but she more covetous would ask for a chain. Master, be wise, and give it to her, she'll shake her chain and frighten us with it!
I pray you, sir, my ring, or else the chain. I hope you not mean to cheat me so.
Avaunt, thou witch! Come, Dromio, let us go!
Fly, princess, the peacock! Mistress, that you now!
Now, Antipolis is mad! Else would he never so demean himself. A ring he hath of mine worth 40 ducats, and for the same he promised me a chain. Both one another he denies me now. The reason I gather is that, well, he is mad. Besides this present instance of his madness is the mad tale today he told at dinner, of his own doors being shut against his entrance, but like his wife acquainted with his fits. My way is now high home to his house, to tell his wife that, being lunatic, that he rushed into my house and took perforce my ring away. This course, I finished shoes. For 40 ducats, it's too much to lose.
So much money to warrant thee as I am rested for. My wife's in a wayward mood today, and will not tend kindly to the messenger that I should be attached in the streets of Ephesus. I tell you, she'll sound harshly in her ear. Here comes my man. I think he brings the money. How now, sir? Have you that I sent you for?
Here is that I warrant you. We'll pay them all!
Well, where's the money?
Why, sir, I gave the money! For the roof!
500 ducats, villain? For a rope?
I'll serve you 500 at the rate!
Thou drunken knave, to what end did I bid thee home?
To a rope then, sir! And to that end, I am returned.
And to that end, you will be welcome.
Oh!
Good sir, be patient.
Nay, 'tis for me to be patient! I am in imprisonment!
Good now, hold not tongue.
Nay, rather persuade him? Hold his hand!
Thou whoreson, senseless villain!
I would I were senseless, sir, that I might not feel your blows!
Thou art senseless for nothing but blows, and so is an ass!
Oh!
Oh!
I am an ass indeed. You may prove it on my long ears. I have served him from the hour of my nativity. I have nothing at his hand to show for my service. But clothes! Where I am warm, he cools me with beating. Where I am cool, he warms me with beating. I am waked with it when I sleep, raised with it when I sit, driven out of doors with it when I go from home. Welcome to home with it!
Great. Go on. My life's coming yonder.
What? Oh, God. Mister, respeque finem, respect your end.
Whoa.
I'm sorry. Oh, boy, cross, let the parrot. Beware the rope's end.
Wilt thou still talk?
Oh!
How say you now? Is your husband not bad?
His incivility confirms no less. Good Dr. Pinch, you are a con.
Fill your ear.
At Darcy, Satan, housed within this man, yield possession to my holy prayers. And to thy state of darkness, hide thee straight. I conjure thee, by all the saints of heaven.
Peace, noting wizard, peace. I am not mad.
Oh, thou wert not poor, distressed soul.
You minion, you! Are these your customers? Did this companion with the saffron face revel in feast in my home, whilst the guilty doors were shut upon me, and I walked out of the house I own?
Oh, husband, God doth know you dined at home today, or else what lets it but you would be here, free from these slanders and this open shame.
Dined at home? Now, villain, what sayest you?
Sir, sooth to say, you did not dine at home.
And were the doors not shut upon me and I locked out?
Then fable, the doors were locked upon you, and you shut out.
And did not she herself revile me there?
Certes she did. She herself reviled you there.
And did not her kitchen maid rail, taunt, and scorn me?
Heard it. Kitchen does still scorn. Yes.
And did not I enrage apart from this?
In verity you did. My bones bear witness that have since felt the vigor of his rage.
Is good to soothe them in these contraries?
It is no shame. The fellow finds his vein, and yielding to him humorous, well, his friend.
What?
Nor, thou hast suborned the goldsmith to arrest me.
I sent you money to be your bail, sir, by Dromio here, who came in haste for it.
Money by me? The heart and goodwill you might, but surely, master, not a rag of money.
He came to me, and I delivered it.
And I am witness with her that she did.
God and the rope maker bear me witness that I was sent for nothing but a rope!
Yes.
Jesus!
Thy men and men. deadly looks. They must be bound.
Hey, lady, it's some dark room.
Whoa. Say, wherefore didst thou lock me forth today? And why dost thou deny the bag of gold?
I did not, gentle husband, lock thee forth.
And gentle master, I received no gold. But I confess, master, that we were locked out.
Dissembling villain, thou speaks false in both.
Dissembling harlot, thou speaks false in all, and our confederate with a damned pack that makes the most of abject scorning.
I've combined and bind them up and not come
near. Who are you?
Let him go. He is my brother. You shall not have him.
Where is every strength to?
Come on, I'll do that. He is. I'll see a bunch of men do outrage and displeasure to him.
Oh! He is my brother. Oh! If I let him go. That death here will be
one crime of me. Okay, stop. Okay. Bye.
That's good.
Is that fair? Oh! Yeah! Shut up! Bear me forward unto his creditor, and knowing how the debt grows, I will pay for it. Good master doctor, see him safe home conveyed to my house. Oh, most unhappy day!
Oh, most unhappy strumpet!
Master, I am entered here in bond for you!
Out on thee, villain! Wherefore dost thou mad me?
Will you be bound for nothing? Be mad, good master! Cry the devil!
The devil!
I mean, how idly do they talk?
Sisters, you will go again. Say now, whose suit was he arrested at?
One Edlo Ico. Do you know him?
Yes, I know the man. What is the sum he owes?
200, doctor.
Oh, God. Say now, how grows it due?
2 points. Chain your husband had on him.
He did bespeak a chain, but I did never see it.
When asked, your husband, all enraged today, came into my house and took away my ring. The same ring I saw on his finger now. Soon after, I did meet him with a chain.
It may be so, but I did never see it. Come, jailer, bring me to where the goldsmith is. I long to know the truth hereof at large.
Oh, shit!
You're
hurt! Come back with me! Come back with me! Come back with me!
I see these witches are afraid of swords.
She will be your wife now, ransom you.
Come to the Centaur, fetch her stuff from thence, along that we were safe and sound aboard.
They stays here tonight. They surely do us no harm. The city speak us fair, give us gold. Methinks they're just gentle nations. Before the mount of mad flesh that claims me a marriage, I can find my heart to stay here, and I wish.
I shall not stay tonight for all the town. Therefore, away to get our stuff aboard.
All right. I'm sorry, but I protest. He had the chain of me, though he most dishonestly doth deny it.
How's this man esteemed here in this city?
Very reverent reputation, sir. Credit infinite, highly beloved, second to none that lives here in the city. His word might bear my wealth at any time.
Oh, speak softly, younger, as I think he walks.
'Tis so. And that same chain about his neck which he forswore most modestly to have. Good sir, draw near to me. Guys. Master Antipholus, I wonder much that you would put me through the shame and trouble, and not without some circumstance yourself, with oaths and promises, so to deny this chain which you now wear so openly. Despite the charges, the shame, the imprisonment, you have done wrong to this, my honest friend, who, but for staying on our controversy, have hoisted sail and set to sea today. This chain you had of me, can you deny it?
I think I have. I never did.
I said you did, and forswore it too.
No harm me to deny it, forswear.
These are mine. Fie on me, villain. It is pity that thou livest to walk right before a bondsman resort.
Villain, thou liest. I'll prove mine honor against thee presently. Thou darest stand.
I do, and I do defy thee as a villain.
Oh, God, I'll make these bad, so give me the death. I'll get you on the way. Bye.
tied Romeo to a chair in the mine house!
Don't mess your room! In the nunnery! He's a real fool!
Get him! He was right there! Oh god, and on. Oh god, and on.
Quiet, people! Wherefore throng you hither?
To fetch my poor distracted husband hence. Let us come in that we may bind him fast and bear him home for his recovery.
I knew he was not in his perfect wits.
I'm sorry to have you drawn,
man. How long has this procession held the man?
This week has been heavy, sour, sad, much different from the man he was. Till this afternoon, his passion here break into extremity of madness.
Hath he not lost much wealth by rack of sea? Buried some dear friend, hath not else. Strained his affection and unlawful love. A sin prevailing much in youthful men who give their eyes the liberty of gazing. Which one of these sorrows is he subject to?
None of these. Except it be the last, namely, some law that drew him off from home.
You should for that have reprehended him.
Why, so I did.
Aye, but not rough enough.
As rough as my modesty would let me.
Happily in private.
And in assemblies too.
Aye, but not enough.
It was a copy of our conference. In bed he slept, not for my urging it. At board he fed, not for my urging it. At home it was the subject of my theme. Still, I did tell him that it was vile and bad.
And thereof came it that the man was mad.
Yes.
The venom, clamors of a jealous woman.
Oh.
Poisons more deadly than a mad dog's tooth. It seems his sleeps were hindered by thy railing. Thou sayest his meat was sauced with thy upbraidings. Unquiet meals make ill digestions. And thereof a raging fire fever bred. And what's a fever but a fit of madness? Thou sayest his sports were hindered by thy brawls. Sweet recreation, bard, what doth ensue? But moody and dull melancholy. Kinsmen to grim and comfortless despair, and at her heels a huge infectious truth, of pale distemperatures and boasts of life. In food, in sport, and life-preserving rest, to be disturbed, would mad, or man, or beast. The consequences, then, thy jealous fits, have scared thy husband from the use of wits.
She never reprehended him, but mildly, when he demeaned himself rough, rude, and wildly. Why bear these rebukes and answers not? She did betray me to my own reproof. Good people, enter and lay hold on him.
Good people, I am.
No, not a creature enters in mine house.
Then let your servants bring my husband forth.
Neither. He took this place for sanctuary, and he shall privilege him from your hands, till I brought him to his wits again, or lose my labor in essaying it.
I will attend my husband, be his nurse, die his sickness, for it is my office, and I will have no attorney but myself. So I beg you, let him be with me.
Patience, for I will not let him stir, till I've used the approved means I have, with wholesome syrups, drugs, and holy prayers, to make of him a formal man again. It is a parcel and branch of mine oath, a charitable duty of my order. Therefore, depart and leave him here with me.
I will not hence and leave my husband here, and how ill it doth beseem your holiness to separate the husband and the wife.
Be quiet and depart, thou shalt not have him.
Complain unto the Duke of his indignity. Come, for I will fall prostrate at his feet, never rise until my tears and prayers have won his grace, to come here in person and take my husband from the abbess.
Oh, by this, the dial points at 5. I'm sure the Duke himself will come this way in person to the Melancholy Alley, the place of death and sorrowful execution, behind the ditches of the Abbey, right here.
Upon what cost?
Oh, to see a revered Syracusan merchant who put unluckily each to bay against the laws and statutes of this town, executed publicly for his offenses.
Oh, yeah. See where they come. We will behold his death.
Yes, sir.
Kneel before the Duke before he passes the Abbey.
Yet once again, I proclaim it publicly. If any friend will pay the sum for him, he shall not die so much that we tended him.
Justice, most secret Duke, against the Abbess.
The virtuous and reverend lady, it cannot be that she hath done thee wrong.
May it please your grace, the Duke is my husband, who I may lord of me and all I had, and your most important letter, this ill day and most outrageous for the time to suit him, that desperately he already seemed to see within his bondman, just as mad as he, doing displeasures to the citizens by rushing into their house of friends, with rings, jewels, anything his rent should like. Once I get him bound and send him home for the wrongs I went, anon I know by what charm he stood, but he broke from those that had the guard with him and his mad attendant, into him with ireful passion, with drawn swords, and madly bent on the streets here, so raised to the poor aid, we came again to bind them, and there they fled to this abbey here, and here the abbey shuts the gates on us, and we're not so
the first to put your mouth. Nor born, no bear him forth hence. Therefore, most gracious Duke, with thy command, let him be brought forth and born hence for help.
Okay. Long since thy husband served me in my wars, and I to thee engaged the prince's word. I mean, to do him all the good and grace I could. Some of you. Yeah, you. You.
Yes, I'm some of you.
You got it. Hey, go tell the other silly to come here, and I'll give you $5. I'll determine this before I start.
Mistress! Mistress!
Bow.
Money.
Okay.
Mistress! Mistress! Shift it, save yourself! My master and his men broke loose. They've beaten the maids who are about the doctor. His beard they stitched off with great braids of fire. They never has a burden. They throw at him great pails of powdered mire to quench the hire. And sure, unless you send some present help, betrayed not, they'll kill the god here.
Peaceful, my man and his master are in there, and that is false of thus report to us.
Mistress, mistress, I tell you true. I have not preached. Almost since I did see it, he cries for you, and vows to take you, and scorch your face and disfigure you.
God.
Ah! Hark, hark, mistress, I hear a fly, be gone!
I come here. God, and Albert.
I mean, it is my husband. Huh? Witnessing that he is born about invisible. Even now we house him in there, and now he's here.
What?
Has thought of human reason.
Justice, most gracious Duke. Oh, grant me justice, even for the services that I long since did for thee, when I bestirred thee in the wars and took deep scars to save thy life. Even for the blood that I lost for thee then, now grant me justice.
Unless your death doth make me dote, see my son Antipholus, and Dromio.
Justice, my sweet prince, against that woman there, she whom thou gavest to me to be my wife, for she hath abused and dishonored me. Even in the strengths and heights of injury, beyond imagination are the wrongs she this day hath shamelessly thrown upon me.
Discover how, and thou shalt find me just.
She this day locked the doors upon me while she, with harlots, feasted in my house.
With harlots? Really? Didst thou so?
No, my good lord. Me, myself, he, and my sister today did dine together. So befall my soul as this falsely burdens me withal. Never may I look on day, nor sleep on night. But she tells your highness simple truth.
A perjured woman! They are both forsworn. In this the madman justly charges them.
My liege, I'm advised with what I say, neither disturbed with the effect of wine, nor heady wrath provoked with a raging eye. This day, that woman walked me out from the house. And this goldsmith here could sit witness with me as his son, for he was with me then. Then, leaving my company to go fetch a chain and promising to bring it to the Porpentine where Balthazar and I did dine together. Our dinner done, and he not coming thither, I went to search for it, and in the street I met him, and in his company that gentleman there. Then this perjured goldsmith swore down to me that I this day of him have received the chain, which God he knows I saw not. And then this goldsmith took the chance to arrest me with an officer, I promising to obey, and sending my peasant home for certain ducats. He with none returned. And so, I fairly bespoke the officer, convincing him to go in person with me to my house. By the way, we met my wife, her sister, and a rabble of more vile confederates. Along with them, they brought one Pinch, a hungry, lean-faced villain, a mere anatomy, a mountebank, a threadbare juggler, and a fortune teller, a sharp-eyed, hollow-looking wretch, a living dead man. There, this pernicious knave took himself on as a conjurer, and gazing in mine eyes, feeling my pulse, with no face as it were outfacing me, cries out that I was possessed. And then they all fell upon me and bound me, and in a dark and dankish vault at home, left me and my man both bound together. Till gnawing with my teeth my bonds in sunder, I gained my freedom. And immediately ran hither to your grace, whom I beseech to grant me ample satisfaction for these deep shames and great indignities.
My lord, in truth, was far at witness with him that he died not at home, but was locked out.
But had he the chain of thee or no?
He had, my lord, and when these people, when he ran into this abbey here, these people saw the chain about his neck.
Yeah.
Oh, so are these here, my then. You did profess that you had a chain of him, right? Of which you foresaw in a march. And thereupon I drew my sword right here on you. And then you fled into the abbey right there. Oh, of which I think you've come by miracle.
I never came within these abbey walls, nor ever didst thou draw thy sword upon me. I never saw the chain, so help me heaven, and this is false you burden me withal.
Cool, okay. This is an interesting speech. I think we're all drinking the Cersei's cup. If here, you housed him, here would have been, right? Right? I mean, if you were mad, you would not plead so coldly. You said he died with you at his house, right?
He said he did.
He said. What say you?
Sir, he died with her there, at the Porpentine.
He did. And from my finger snatched that ring.
Villain.
'Tis true, my liege. This ring I had of her.
You saw him enter at the abbey here?
As sure, my liege, I do see your grace.
Okay, this is nuts. This is strange. Go call the abbess hither. I will determine this before I stir.
Oh, most mighty Duke, without shaking me, speak a word. The Icier friend will save my life and pay the sum that may deliver me.
Speak freely, Sir Kirsten, and what thou wilt.
Is that your name, sir? Called Antiphilus.
Huh?
Is not that your bondman, Dromio?
Within this hour I was his bondman, sir. But he, I thank him, gnawed into my cords. Now I am Dromio, and his man, unbound.
I am sure you both remember me.
Ourselves we do remember by you, sir, for lately we were tied up as you are now. You are not one of Pinch's patients, are you, sir?
Why look you strange on me? You know me well.
Wait, well, no, I've never seen you before in my life.
Reef at change me since you saw me last, and time's deformed hand hath written strange features in my face. But tell me yet, dost thou not know my voice?
Nope, neither.
Dromio? Nor thou?
No, trust me, sir, nor I.
Oh, I am sure thou dost.
Aye, sir, but I am sure I do not. And that which a man denies, you are now bound to believe him. Me.
Not know my voice? Oh, time's extremity! Hast thou so cracked and splitted my poor tongue in 7 short years that here, my only son, knows not my feeble key of untuned cares? Oh, though this face of mine have be hid in sack-and-sling winter's drizzled snow, and all the conduits of my blood froze up, yet hath my night of life some memory, my wasting lamps, some fading glimmer left, my dull deaf ears, little used to hear. All these old witnesses I cannot dare. Talk about my son, Antipolis.
I've never seen my father before in my life.
But 7 years since in Syracuse, boy, thou knowest me, pardon. But perhaps, my son, thou shamest to acknowledge me in misery.
Nah, the Duke and all those in the city who know me can witness with me that it is not so. I never came within Syracuse in my life.
Yeah, I tell thee, Syracuse, 20 years have I known Antipolis. And at that time, he never saw Syracuse. I see thy dangers and age make thee dope.
Yeah.
What the high?
There's an imposter among us.
What's mine to do? Behold, a man much wrong.
I see 2 husbands, or my eyes deceive me.
One of these men, any genius to the other. And which of these? Which is the natural man and which is the spirit? Who deciphers these 2?
I, sir, Dromio. Command him away!
Well, I, sir, am Dromio! Pray, let me stay!
He stays.
Aegean art thou not? Or else his ghost?
How, my old master! Who hath bound him here?
Whoever bounds him, I will loose his bonds and gain a husband by his liberty.
What?
Speak, Lord Aegean, speak, if thou beest the man that hast the wife once named Amelia, that bore thee and a burden 2 fair sons. Oh, if thou beest the same Aegean, speak and speak unto the same Amelia.
I mean, this is the morning story, right? You don't.
These two Antipholuses, these two so alike, and these two Dromios, I mean, one in semblance, besides her urging of a racket seat, these are the parents to these children. Like, they're accidentally met together.
If I dream not, thou art Amelia. If thou art she, tell me, where is that son that floated with thee on the fateful raft?
By men of Epidamium, he and I and the twin Dromio all were taken up. But by and by, when fishermen of Corinth took Dromio and my son from them, with me they left with those of Epidamium. What then became of them I cannot tell. I to this fortune that you see me in.
Tiflis.
That's came from Corinth first.
No, sir, not I. I came from Syracuse.
I came from Corinth, sir.
And I with him.
Brought by that most famous warrior, Duke Manaphon, and your most renowned uncle.
Which of you two did dine with me today?
I, gentle mistress.
And are you not my husband?
Nope. No, I say nay to that.
Oh.
And so did I. And did she call me so? And this fair gentlewoman, her sister, did call me brother. What I said to you then, I hope I shall have leisure to meet. Make good. This be not a dream I see and hear.
Wait! Wait! That is the chain which you had of me.
I think it is. I deny it not.
That's the chain you had me arrested for.
Oh. It is, sir. I deny it not.
And I sent you money, sir, to be your bail by Dromio here, but I think you brought it not.
Nay, not by me. This purse of ducats I did receive from you, by Dromio. I see we still did meet each other's man, and I was taken for him, and he for me. And thereupon these errors are arose.
These ducats I pawned for my father here.
It shall not need.
Can I have them?
Okay. I thought I had this life.
Yeah!
Yeah! Yeah! Oh,
can I arrest him again?
Sir, I must have that diamond from you.
Yeah, do so. Much thanks for my good cheer.
Renowned Duke, vouchsafe to take the pains to go with us into the abbey here, and here at large discoursed all our fortunes, and all that are assembled in this place, that by this sympathized one day's error, have suffered wrong. Go, keep us company, and we shall make full satisfaction. 33 years have begun but in travail of you, my sons, until this present hour, my heavy burden near delivered. The Duke, my husband, and my children both, and you, the calendars of their nativity, go to a gossip's feast and joy with me, after so long grief, such nativity.
I think with all my heart, I'm a gossip at this feast.
Minus thou embarked, Dromio.
You're back, sir.
He speaks to me. I am your master, Dromio. Come, we'll look to that anon. Where's thy brother there? Rejoice with him.
That's a fine friend of your master's house. That kitchen needs me at dinner. Show me my sister, not my wife.
Now, let's go arm in arm. That one.